at campus while I was part of two startups. That was, I think, 2000 was the year for the boom here, when the first startups at campus were happening. So there were two which were from our department plus our friends, something called Right Hub. You remember that or not? And the second was Mizus, which is still there. So I was part of Mizus for a while, helping them build a team with a technology startup in mobile computing. This was while I was at campus. I did work with another Swedish company called Wind, which has now spun off the product which we work as an R&D with them called Neo Technology. So you can check that out at the website neotechnologies.org. It's like a different form of data storage tool. So we had helped them design it, implemented a prototype. So this was 11 years ago, and about 4 years ago they spun it off as a separate company, and it's a product in itself which people are using. So that's while I was at IIT. I think, of course, did the regular summer internships, etc. So I worked at IBM, ISC Bangalore, TIFR, all kinds of research stuff. So at that time, it seemed life was very different and very, very researchy in some ways. But got first day, or sort of the first job I applied for was McKinsey on campus. At that time, honestly, I didn't know what McKinsey did. It was the first year they were coming on campus. Ours was the first batch they actually recruited from IIT Bombay. Got through it. It was one of those sort of category A, and you can't sit for anything else after that. And my dream job at that time was, in fact, not McKinsey, it was Cisco. So I wanted to go to Cisco, continue working in networking. But as chance would have it, Cisco was scheduled to come earlier to McKinsey, but they changed their date. They came later. I got through McKinsey, so I couldn't even sit for Cisco. That's such is life. Then I stayed with McKinsey, worked with them for 6.5 years. Worked in very different sectors, healthcare and the social sector or the development sector. These two sectors I primarily worked in. Then about 5 years ago almost, decided to leave McKinsey, saying I'd done a lot of consulting, left McKinsey at that time, decided, then started looking at what to do. So at some level I was still in, I just decided to leave. I didn't know exactly what I would be doing after that. Spent a few months, tried working with, started another startup which I left in 2-3 months. I didn't really start it, I just sort of conceptualized it, but realized that me and the founder, another IIT Bombay friend, were sort of looking at it in different ways. So decided to leave that. He continued with it. That was Chopati, which is now being bought over by Future Bazaar. So Future Bazaar is working. That was with Kashyap. And then again sort of we started thinking, and that's when the idea of Swast came along. Because of partly my work at McKinsey, where I was looking at healthcare and the development sector, and sort of said, okay, let's do something in health for low-income households. So, because people who do not have enough money particularly get most affected by health, and they are least able to pay for it also, for good healthcare. So let's create something which can try and provide them good health services at low income, for the low income. I was lucky enough to have my batchmate who had followed a similar but different trajectory. After IIT, went to KPMG, was there for 7 years in consulting as well, Ankur. So he was also sort of itching. We call it the 7 year itch in at consulting. So he was itching to leave it as well. I called him, his story, famous story is I called him on Thursday night at home for dinner, and Monday he resigned. So that he was that much itchy in some way. So so then we started May 2008, finally we started Swast India. It's been 4.5 years since we have been at it now, trying to make some, trying to take a actually a very engineering view to a healthcare problem. So that's I think where we find it interesting. We've not become doctors, but we are using what we learned here to apply to a different domain. With this, I'll just show a short video about what we do there, and then we can discuss. This is history. I leave it more epic. We just want to answer questions that you have rather than sort of talk more about myself.
Thank you. Mumbai, India's most populous city, the financial capital of India, home to one of the world's largest film industries. The city of skyscrapers, fast life, and a plethora of opportunities for everyone. The city has the potential to offer a higher living standard than any other part of the country. City of dreams. Every morning at 6, Shankabai, a housemaid, travels a long distance to work. While Nathu opens his tea stall even before the crack of dawn. Kuli Shahabuddin's days become nights while he carries the passenger's luggage. Ganesh cycles for miles to sell bread and eggs for his daily wage. Similarly, Ramdayal Rikshawala, Mason Hari, Vada Pav seller Vishnu, and many more struggle every day to make ends meet. But in this fast-paced life, even one pay can wreck their whole budget. Increasing expenses and struggle to gain basic living leaves them with no savings. They can't afford proper medical facilities. They face high interest debts for medical emergencies. And one hospital visit can wipe out their yearly savings. Is to pilot out a sustainable model for 10 medical centers in Mumbai covering 100,000 lives. And by 2018, it aims to cover at least 10 million lives. Swasth India is the brainchild of its young and foresightful founders, Sandeep Kapila and Ankur Pate, IIT Mumbai alumni, who began such a revolutionary journey towards improving the health scenario in India. Both Sandeep and Ankur have a mission to make healthcare accessible to all in India.
High quality standards of treatment.
provides experienced doctors for consultation at a nominal fee, as well as highly subsidized pathology tests and medicines. Swasth India abides by the latest quality standards and maintains computerized billing and medical records. The number of people needing such services in India is close to 700 million. It's a long journey for Swasth India, with a lot of support needed from like-minded individuals and organizations who are passionate about bringing equity and security in health for the poor. We are eager for your participation. Come join hands with Swasth India. Let's bring health for all.
Once you've seen them from inside, how these things operate, that's an experience. The second component was about myself, and again, McKinsey helped a lot because you were put in very different situations every time, right? So you were putting in a situation where you were talking to a 50-year-old guy, you are 23, 24, something like that, and he's been in that industry for 30 years, doing only this entire his life, and you are supposed to advise him and say that what you're doing is wrong and you should do it differently. So you are, that's the kind of situation you are put in. So you go through those situations, you learn to handle them. In that process, you learn about yourself in terms of how best you handle these things, what are your strengths, what are your weaknesses. Of course, this is coupled with an intensive program from McKinsey or any consulting organization for that, which is focused on helping you become better as a professional, not just for McKinsey's sake, but in general. So there is a discovery process. So both of those happened, which was very interesting. And at the end of 3 years, which is the typical tenure of an analyst at McKinsey, I had the choice of, which what most people do, go find another job from McKinsey, go do an MBA, go do some other degree if you want, or stay at McKinsey. And I was luckily given that choice of staying at McKinsey also, which I wanted to do because I was enjoying myself. I said, this is good, I'm learning more and more every day. So I kept on doing that for another 3.5 years. There, at this time I got, I think, really lucky. I had a project for 3 years. Out of those extra years, I just worked on one project for 2.5-3 years, which was with the state police department, Maharashtra Police Department. So the, McKinsey was doing advising the department on how to improve their processes as an organization and how to become more efficient. So, and it was a long-term project, so I started working on it and kept on going for 2.5-3 years. And it gave, I think, the interesting thing why the reason I kept on going was also was because it was very interesting to see a very different India from the lens of the police force. Right? So we typically hate the police. We think they are corrupt. They are only here to trouble us. Mama ne pakad liya, fine maar diya, ye traffic problem, wo kyun kha rahe ho, kuch faltu mein sirf paise khane ke liye karta hai. Passport, if anyone has got it verified here, you know, they will ask you to get it xeroxed and all of that. So we worked with them on the ground to see how you can re-engineer some of the processes of the police force, make them more transparent at the grassroots level. So like just like the bank, we actually designed what a police station should look like. We implemented it. Some processes have stuck. The problem is these things don't stick so easily. But some have stuck through that and some have not. Some have fallen through and gone back to the police. But again, that sort of gave me a very different flavor of what things are really like through the lens of a police force, which only sees disputes. Policeman only sees disputes. He is at a place because two people are fighting. So he only sees the worst part of the society, literally, where people are fighting all the time. So I got to see that. Then moved on to back to some sort of regular corporate work at McKinsey, which I stopped liking after I worked with the police force. I suddenly thought, what's this? This doesn't, didn't seem like material issues to me. Trying to, in some ways, very crudely I put it, making a rich man richer. So I was working with a corporate head who had some, already is a multi-crore, multi-billion dollar person in HNI, working with his company and trying to let him earn a few more million dollars, a few more crore rupees. So it didn't seem, honestly, stopped seeming interesting to me. And on the other side, at McKinsey, it became sort of a career choice. So after 6-7 years, you become a manager, you've done a lot of work, which is like you managed a very complex project or assignment on your own almost. The next stage, even internally in McKinsey, is to become more of a, like a, become a partner, become a more of a consultant. So that role is where you sort of, that's when I think, at least I feel at McKinsey or any consulting company, you would make a choice whether you want to be a consultant for life or you want to do something else. Right? So till then it's very generic. So till then whatever I learned, I could apply it and I have applied it here. If I had gone to another industry, I would have applied it there. It was very general, basic, good practices type management skills. But I think beyond that, it would all have been very specific to consulting. How do you negotiate a study, for example? Right? How do you talk to a client, convince him that he needs you and pays you a lot of money to tell him what he knows about? So that kind of thing starts happening. And that's something which didn't excite me. I felt that I didn't want to be, at least at that stage, a consultant for life. I definitely wanted to do something, execute something, implement something on my own. As a consultant, you are advising. You are advising on how to implement. You are supporting on implementing, but you are never implementing at best. So you are never the guy where the gun is on your head. It's always on someone else's head, and you are just standing by him at best, if at all you are standing by him. So that's something I wanted to try. That's when I said, I'm leaving. I didn't know what I was going to do, but I just said, I'm leaving definitely. And sort of my work before got me interested in the development sector. Because I had worked there with the police department, and my other work with the governments, with other NGOs, which McKinsey also works with. So wanted to work in the development sector. Healthcare was something again I had worked a lot in. So these two sort of started coming together once I started thinking what I wanted to do, and that's how first thing here. So that, I think, answers both your questions, right? Your question. So we want to definitely build it as a self-sustaining organization. But I think having said that, so we are actually a company. We are not registered like a charitable organization, essentially. We are both entities, but primarily a company. So our belief is that we can provide good quality care at reasonable rates, which are about 40 to 50% lower than current market rates. So all our services at the center you saw, they are not free. They will be at about 40 to 50% lower than market, so which is the drugs, for example. So a typical visit would cost anywhere between 150 to 300. If you go to a doctor, his fees will be 50 to 100 rupees. And you write a prescription, you will go and buy drugs easily 100 to 200, sometimes even more. So that would be the typical benchmark. At our place, a visit is about 80 to 100 rupees, including drugs, including tests, everything. So the idea is to provide good quality care at lower rates. And these are still at a profit, so it's not like that's my cost. Our cost is lower than that. So at a certain point, about 30, 40 visits a day, our center will start recovering the fixed cost that we invest, which is the salaries and the rents, etc. So the idea is to build it as a self-sustaining organization. Having said that, initially there are losses, right? So when you set that center up, we spend about a few lakhs to set it up, get it in the right situation. We spend, and then there are, till we break even, there are losses that we incur, etc. So for that, we raise capital in different ways, raise finance in different ways, including we are open to donations, grants, you know, sort of forms, you know, this has to be a pure business kind of approach. We sort of say it's fine if somebody sees this really as a social venture, as a social thing that we are doing. Just like any other NGO would get donations, we are also open to them. At the same time, for some large investors, we also raise money through normal equity type stuff, which is any what a startup would do. So we use both means to raise money initially, but eventually, yes, we should be recovering our cost. That's the idea.
How relevant is your engineering degree when it comes to consultancy?
This degree, sorry.
The computer science degree. Yeah. Or any engineering degree.
I think very relevant. So, and that's the reason why consulting companies come here also. So, initially, consulting companies look for, in general, to some extent, very raw problem-solving power, right? Which is, can you take a problem and try and do anything that is required to solve it, right? So there is a problem statement that, for example, how do I reduce cost in a plant by 30%? That's a typical problem statement for a consulting company. Now, how do you go about doing it? Requires some sort of an approach in terms of, okay, where is the cost? Which is what an engineer, I think, would instinctively do, because that's how we deal with our own problems and we face in any degree for that matter, right? So we structure it, okay, these are the elements. What can be done to reduce cost here, 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 here? Keep evaluating that, keep going in depth wherever is required. Prioritize where you need to go in depth or not. Just like typically we give our exams like that. We know, okay, these are the 10 most important questions, right? Nobody studies the whole course, or very few people study the whole course. We know, okay, these are the 10 important sections. That's prioritization. So you learn that every day in and out here, very instinctively. That's what you apply there. So it's, and then of course the general comfort with numbers. Everything in a consulting firm is about numbers, because that's why you are, because you are working with a third party. Just talking actually doesn't help, which is the usual belief that that's what consultants do, they just talk. But that doesn't help with clients. With clients you have to be really specific, because they know general talking, that myth is there. People know that's what consultants do. So they want very specific things. For specificity, usually you need facts, you need numbers, you need to be able to manipulate numbers, not manipulate in the bad sense, but actually work with them, analyze them, etc. So those are very generic skills which we would learn here in any department, and those are applied. Very specific skills are rarely used. That's the other important thing, I think. So when I joined McKinsey, I wanted to work in financial sector and the IT sector, because I was from computer science, so I thought I would be able to do better in IT and or at least learn more about that sector, and finance because it's about numbers and I like maths and also. And those are the two sectors I never ended up working at technically. In fact, I worked at, as I said, petroleum, oil and gas, healthcare, which had nothing to do with that. But the same principles are fine. But healthcare, I was actually one sitting with a R&D guy from who was obviously a PhD in chemistry, etc., and trying to understand what's the chemical reaction happening in the plant because of which this is the yield and this yield was driving the cost. So how do you reduce cost? How do you increase yield? So using very basic chemistry to understand it. Just asking the right questions, not necessarily solving it. They will solve it. You will solve it. The pressure is lesser. Standard of service, right? So currently if I go to a slum, you go to a slum, right? So what is the doctor or the physician he goes to? It's not an MBBS doctor. It's usually a, or even in rural India, it's even worse. It's like a chola chak guy who has no degree. In Bombay, it's an Ayurvedic or a homeopathic or a Unani doctor practicing allopathy, right? So that's the best he gets. There is no chance of an MBBS doctor. So in our center, they are all MBBS doctors. So, and these are all 35-year-old. 35-year experience. So these are mostly retired doctors, 50-55 years. They have been working with this segment for very long to know what kind of ailments are there. So from a doctor standpoint, the quality is, I think, superior than what they usually see. In terms of medicines, again, it's stripped back from the best companies. It's at par, if not better. Same with tests. So quality is, yeah, it would be better than what I think they get today. It may not be, or I think in India, it's, it would be at par on medical terms, but on housekeeping terms or hospitality terms, which is part of the healthcare industry, right? You are in a private room or an AC room, or that is not there, because that's the idea. It's like a general ward kind of situation, but basic again, hygiene, sanitation, those standards are meant to make sure that there is no, yeah.
Are you using generic
Sorry?
Are you using
generic drugs? So yeah, that's a good question. So this is again something you know when you are inside the industry, and usually, at least right now, people are talking about generic drugs in IIT. I didn't know about generic drugs. I thought, yeah, whatever the doctor writes is the drug I have to take. Now in India, really, generic means is it patent protected or not? Right. So in India, only five salts are patent protected, and these are what salts? These are salts which are for usually for cancer treatment right now. So those are the 3-4 very high cost, only 1 lakh rupees a vial, etc., which are never going to be used at our center for primary care, or for that matter, not necessarily that critical for anyone. Doctors are not sure how to use them also, so they are still learning those kinds of stuff. And the rest are all generics, they are off patent. So there is nothing stopping me from going to a manufacturer and saying, make this for me, put Swasth brand name on it, and we can provide that. So it's as simple as that. So in that sense, everything is generic, whether you buy it from a chemist shop, what the doctor writes is also generic. The only difference is, when the doctor writes something, he has been incentivized by the pharma company to write that particular brand. So in paracetamol, he's been taught to write Rosine, but there are 2000 other brands of the same drug, which is paracetamol, which will reduce your fever by the same amount. It will treat you the same way, there will be no difference. It will be probably half or 1/10 the price than Rosine. But the doctor doesn't write it, so you don't know about it. And they are usually called as generics, but that's not really true. Everything is a generic. Crocine tries to, or brands like Crocine try to think that, oh, they are better because they are not generics, but that's not the case. All the drugs are same. They have the same quality standard. And when I have worked at McKinsey, I have seen drugs come out of the same plant. They come out like this. There are different labels stamped on them, and one is called a generic and one is not. So it's that level of bad. And that is what I saw from inside, which sort of set me over. This is how bad the situation is, and the impact, as you saw, it's like 32 million people going below poverty line due to stuff like this, because we don't know. And it's in a place like this at IIT, I didn't know. You know about generics, which is good. Probably saw Amir Khan's show, most likely. That would be my guess. So it's a recent knowledge, which is very good. I think that's a good thing that has happened. But that's one thing detail he missed out, that actually everything is generic in India. So, what is the bad thing that is happening is now people are classifying generics and non-generics in a way as if generics are poor quality. That's the assumption. And that's not at all true, because everything is the same quality or should be the same quality. Obviously, if anything else, there is difference in manufacturing quality. The government should take care of, but these are the same. So, in short, we have brands. We don't have products without brands. They are all stripped back. There is no loose drugs, which are usually given, like you saw, you see tablets in packets of 1,000, not in a strip. So they are at par again or better than what you get at a pharmacy. These are from multinational companies like Sandoz, Zydus, Cadila, and Abbott. So there is no doubt on what quality or the quality of those. But we do get them at very low cost. That's how we manage to give them discounts and still make a profit.
The doctors that work at your center, are they paid salary at par
with
the market, or
are
they just
going
for a
salary at par? Because again, all the staff, they get paid salary at par. Only people, I think, who are not being paid at par are some people in the central team who are sort of there because they think this is the right thing. So there are about 3-4 people, mostly excited, like my people. Otherwise, all others are paid at par. So saying this is. So we recently actually, that guy is at par almost. So somebody from IIT Kharagpur has joined us. This year he passed out, this year he joined us. So yeah, he's I think what he would have got at campus kind of thing. But some of the senior guys might, yeah, 3-4 would be not at par. But their par would be very high, that's why they're not at par. It's good enough to lead a good life. Doctors, nurses, all at par. Otherwise it cannot be self-sustaining, that's the fundamental. They will do it for 1 month, 2 months, then they will go away. So we have to make sure they are there, they want to be there.
Reducing power 50% is quite large. How do you manage it?
How do you manage it? So the reality is that's the real cost. The cost that today when you walk in, right, and you pay say 100 rupees or 300 rupees, let's say 100 rupees, let's go with that. The real cost of that transaction is only 20 or 25 rupees. 75 is just super normal profit, which is happening due to this kind of information asymmetry. That you don't know that there is a drug which is cheaper, or even the doctor doesn't know that the drug's actual manufacturing cost is actually so low. He's going by what the rep, pharma rep is coming and telling him. He does not know, for example, in a test, every test, like Amir Khan which said, the doctor gets a cut of 30-40%. Why should that cut be there? That's just the cost which is been built up, which has no rationale for being there. The 30-40% is given to the doctor, which increases the cost. We do all tests in-house, so we don't have to give any 30-40% to them. So my cost, even if I'm operating at the same cost as the lab, I'm still in profit there actually, because this is just additional cost which should not be there in the system. It is there because if you think of it as an engineer, and that's where we are applying our engineering scheme, this is the inefficiency of the system. When information is not getting transmitted in the correct fashion, right? There is resistance in the system. So that resistance is taking that energy. If you build a loop, you will start seeing that very clearly. That as you see from the doctor, how the patient is going. He does not know what's the right path to follow. He just goes blindfolded, right? Saying this is what the doctor has told me, I'll do this. That's the case with most of us, right? When we never question the doctor, that's the one guy we never negotiate with. We negotiate with everyone else. But we never negotiate with the doctor. He will galat dawa na de de mere ko. We never do that, right? That's the situation. And that's that is causing an inefficiency. Right? Any closed circuit, electric, civil, anything you build, if there is such levels of inefficiency, the cost will be high. Because that's the cost of inefficiency. So we are trying to remove that inefficiency from the system and build a closed, efficient system where in one place we have everything. And hence there is none of these sort of interconnect charges in some places. That's what is interconnect charges, because the pharma company is paying interconnect to the doctor to write his brand. The lab is paying the doctor to write his lab's prescription. The hospital is paying the doctor to refer the patient to him. So all of those are interconnect charges. They're saying, let's remove them. Because they are not, that's causing inefficiency.
What is the profit sharing?
Sorry?
What is the percentage of profit sharing?
Who? We are making. So right now, our centers, these centers are about 15 months old, the oldest one. There we are just about breaking even. We haven't yet completely reached, saying we have broken even for a few months continuously. But at peak, which is the monsoon season, unfortunately in healthcare you start talking of seasons when people fall more ill and less ill. But at peak we did break even in July, August when monsoons were heavy and people were falling more ill. But right now we are not, so we haven't made a profit in that sense till now. We could have, if we said instead of giving 40% discount, I give only 20%. And people would not have cared because it's still one lesser than what they are getting anywhere else. And two, again, they don't negotiate with doctors, including our doctors. So it's our choice. So we didn't increase the price, otherwise we would have. So, yeah, we haven't made a profit till on these centers. Right? But our goal is also to make them self-sustaining. Forget profit. If even if we make profit, we will only invest in starting more centers. That's the goal.
Which
thing
you
are pulled
to come in this social activity?
Why did I come in this social activity? So, I think partly this, just I think in, maybe to some extent, the instinctive hatred for inefficiency, right? As an engineer, at least you start seeing that more and more. Anything which is inefficient, you don't. And once you're inside, so that's what McKinsey provided me that lens, right? And then when you go inside, you saw what's happening in the industry, how the doctors are behaving, what's their criteria for prescription writing, what's happening in drug manufacturing, how do hospitals think about patients. So all of that you see, there's lots of inefficiencies there in health. And then of course, you see the impact of it, what impact such things have on people, particularly the low income. So I think a combination of that sort of said, okay, let's do something about it. Something has to be done. I think after 6.5-7 years at McKinsey, that's probably the best thing also I could have done. Otherwise, it would have been a restart.
What
was
the response from the people?
Consumers? Very positive. I would say very positive. So we are very glad. That's why, as I said, in those sectors, at 12 to 15 months, we are reaching a break-even kind of thing. It's a good business in some ways. Typical, just to benchmark it, when a doctor starts his own practice, right, it takes him 2 to 3 years to reach the level which we reach in market. And I think that's very encouraging. There are often those cases where they are very grateful because something like reasonably magical happened because they came early and detected something early, which is the objective. But yeah, otherwise, it's, I think, been positive.
And this is only for BPL population?
So we don't think of it. BPL is again a government statistic, right? So they come up with some 60-page form where they try to say, "Sir, you have a TV, you have this, that, and all." And across India, they have the same way of defining BPL. So we don't believe that somebody in Bombay at 20,000 rupees per month has a tougher life than 20,000 rupees per month in rural India, or even for that matter, in another city in India. So you can't define BPL in the same way. The way we have defined it is people living in slums, as simple as that. So our centers are right in the slums, so only people from there come there. We have, and those are all not exactly BPL, but they have a tough lifetime. I don't think it's an easier life. Health-wise, they are more at risk because of hygiene, sanitation, stress levels, everything being higher. So that's how we are defining it. We don't take any other meeting. So we've seen people there with bikes and all, so we say, okay, but they're still vulnerable.
If you were to franchise your model, what would be the average establishment and running cost?
How you bring this model from paper to the floor, like as you just discussed, you discuss it with your friend at your dinner, and how you bring this model to reality and this problem?
Yes, the work ethic and the efficiency.
What are the steps like once we have decided the strategy that we have to do?
That's a good question. So I think that's good for somebody wanting to probably think of starting something now. And I think the one learning I'll start with and then I'll go on the more details. I think when we started it, at least at IIT, we used to think entrepreneurship was very sexy. Bahut cool cheez hai, startup karo, khud karo, ye karo. I think it's very tough, it's not easy. That's why I think it's simple, it's not, it takes a lot of time and effort. We've been at it for, and particularly if you pick something like this up, it's even more challenging because you're trying to solve one of the more tougher problems. Start a normal business, I think in 4 years, you would have been 4.5 years, you would have been at a much higher scale of operation or more successful than we are now because it's a tougher problem. So what we did, I'll tell you our journey once we started something like this. Because the nature of the problem, the first 4 or 5 months, we just said we'll not do anything, we'll just travel across India. We traveled most of West and South India. We didn't go to North and East. And because once we traveled West and South, we said, ये भी बहुत बड़ा problem है, इसी को solve करने के लिए तो बहुत North and East is even tougher because the availability of doctors, the health professionals is lesser than in West and South. But prosperity is lesser. We know all those things, statistics and demographic statistics and all that. So we know the situation is worse. So even if we solve this problem, which is bad enough, it's good. वाला तो करना और मुश्किल होगा. So let's take a smaller problem. Honestly, that was one humbling effect. The first we had. We wanted to solve the whole India's problem first. When we traveled across West and South, people are like, "नहीं हो सकता. This is such a micro and problem which requires a very customized and local solution. That we can't even find a solution which will work across India. It's a million Indias. हमने कहा भाई हमारी aspiration कम करते हैं. Let's see if we can solve West and South India. That was our first humbling effect. Once you start trying to do something on how to solve it. Of course, it told us that West and South there were some commonalities in problem, in the nature of solution. We spoke to, so in that travels, what we did, we went with other NGOs who were working there. So we got a chance to meet people, meet doctors there, meet healthcare professionals, meet the whole, everyone, government officials, etc. And we realized we needed the NGOs to do that, because otherwise if I go to a village in India today, they will say, who are you, why should I talk to you, what are you going to do, all of those kind of things. There are no one there, they don't know us also. So we needed that entry group. So first we did just that, just the general to understand what the real grassroots problem is. Because again, as consultants you are at, based on where you are, from 10,000 to 100,000 feet. You're nowhere near the ground in terms of where the problem situation is. That's a different life of a consultant. So that is one thing we did. We went around. From that we basically concluded that the solution was not some fancy medical, at least from our side, we don't think the solution is some fancy medical thing, technical thing, or a new technology product or anything like that. The solution, at least for us, lay in creating a system. So creating a good healthcare system where the different components interact in the right way because of this inefficiency that is. And that's what causes that information asymmetry is the biggest gap with the consumer. So that's what this travel told us. See, that was the commonality of the problem across the world. The doctors were there, the medicines were there, the labs were there, the hospitals were there. Everything was there. The problem was that they were working in a way which was not optimal for the people, for the consumer. They were working in a way which was optimal for themselves, each one of them. So they are making the most money. The doctors are, the drug companies are, the labs are, but at the cost of the people. The fact that 32 million people are going below poverty line, they are taking a loan, means they have gone somewhere, right? They have met a doctor, and it's a doctor who flees them because of which they ended up in this situation. So there is a doctor. So those components were there, but the system was broken. I think the reason we didn't go north and east was this only, because there our understanding still, we haven't traveled much, but our understanding is the problem is different. The components are missing. If you want to find a doctor, oftentimes in places like Odisha, Bihar, doctors are not there enough. And that you can trace back to number of medical colleges, as simple as that. Right? The number of medical colleges, if you start plotting between north and east, then you start looking at salaries of doctor salaries expectations. So a market salary in Delhi is 50,000 for a doctor. In Bombay, it's 25,000 because there are more doctors. That's the demand supply in manpower. So there are doctor things is really king in the north. If you go there, you'll find that mindset. In west and south, they are much more sort of humble. We realize that yeah, there are many more like.
Sir, lots of people see consultant jobs to be as a stepping stone to doing a MBA in foreign universities. What is your take on that? I mean, the opportunities, do they improve, the funding, etc.
The opportunities improve to get into MBA or?
Yeah, getting into an MBA.
So, bad question for me because I consciously took a call not to do an MBA in life.
Yeah, but you'll have your peers.
Yeah, I think right? Looking at them, yes, it does. I wouldn't say it doesn't. So it does. If that's your goal, consulting is a good thing to get there.
And it'll be funded.
It'll
be funded by the company.
Not necessarily. That depends. How the company sees you. Do you get back? No, it's not entirely funded. Definitely, never entirely funded. Obviously, a certain loan you are stuck with.
The government has an initiative that they will send doctors who have just passed out from AIIMS or something, and they will provide them a good salary. to the villages, but many doctors don't like that. So how is your company different from that initiative?
So we are right now working in urban slums. So we are right now not working in rural. We have worked in rural before in the first 3 years of our work. Then, but we are not working right now there. Having said that, what we have seen of rural, I think doctors, it's not like doctors don't want to go there. They will go there. MBBS doctors is a very different breed of animal, but so there they will have to think differently. The government has now come up with a 3.5 year course also, which is specifically designed for this. They say non-MBBS, but qualified to prescribe medicine. So that's the idea, that they can go there and work. It's a lower cost course. The aspirations are different. So they are solving this problem in different ways, different state governments, but not necessarily schools.
Also, I would like to ask, what kind of skills did you require to start up this company? I mean, we only have an idea that we only have an idea for now, let's say. And what do we need, like legal aspects and management and engineering? So, which are the subjects do we require to start a company?
I think to start with, honestly, you need to know what problem are you trying to solve. So what is the goal of the company, not in terms of what size you want to be, how big you want to be. I want to be a 100 crore company, not in those terms, but your goals in terms of what specific problem are you trying to solve. Identifying that problem and saying, this is the problem I want to solve, then finding an approach on how to solve it. But before that, you have to make sure that this is a big enough problem. From there, all your numbers will come. So that to me is the first step. All legal shingle will come later on. Because if this is not there, then the company doesn't exist, according to me. So if you're not solving a problem which is there to be solved, a meaningful problem is there to be solved, then whatever legal structures you have, whatever knowledge, engineering, technology, product you create, won't be useful because it's not solving a problem. So that to me is the first thing. The second is, yes, then there are other aspects, the practical aspects on how you want to solve it. And those are, I think, there will be many, that's not that complex, honestly, in terms of solving. It seems more complex than it is, but that's not that complex. You can figure those out once you, if you can solve this bigger problem on what you are solving, what is the problem you are addressing. Legal is very simple. Registering a company is today a 1 week's job. It can be done on the internet. You don't need a CA to do that. It's as simple as that, registration of a company. Register of companies is a website. You upload your documents there. There are two documents, memorandum of articles, articles of association. Templates of those are available on the company. Google how to start a company, you will find a stepwise legal guide on how to start it. That is, I think, the least of the problems. Yeah.
Similar to that, what kind of skill set do you require? Or, you know, like, before you sit for placements or before you go for a consult job, like self-analysis, and see if you fit in that particular frame. So what kind of skill set? Because it's a career talk, it's not a, like, it's not for swasthing in particular or for startups in particular, but it's a career talk.
So for a consult job, so I think, yeah, I have interviewed also, so I have been an interviewee.
Yeah, so
I can say from that point in terms of what would a consulting firm look for. Consulting firms look for these basic things, like, which is problem solving ability, your basic interpersonal skills or communication skills, and leadership potential. Third and fourth is business acumen. Right? So, in each one of those, for example, in problem solving, they're trying to see, that's where you get a case study. Right? So, essentially, they're trying to see whether you can take any problem and have a good approach to solving it. You have an approach to solving it. This is what I said. Again, instinctively you develop. You can, again, you'll find ways on how to solve a cracker case in some way. But again, there is no right or wrong answer. I can, as an interviewer, it is, that's how to do it. There's no right or wrong answer. It's more, are you following a systematic approach? Are you following some approach? Are you able to get, are you comfortable with numbers, if the case involves numbers, etc. kind of things. On interpersonal skills, essentially, usually the person interviewing is at least a team manager. So he basically checks, can you be part of a team? So would I like you to be part of my team? It's as subjective as that, right? So you may gel with the interviewer, so he will like you. You may not gel. It's as simple as that. So, but That's essentially what he's trying to say. Because I have to work, so at consulting, one of the things that happens is that your entire life is your team. Right? So 5 days a week, Monday to Friday, definitely. 14 hours, 12 hours, you are with your team. You are oftentimes at not your home place, so you are in a town outside, you are living in a hotel, where the only people you know is your team. So you are only spending time with your team. So it's very important that you are able to spend time with your team, outside of work as well, not just at work. That is an equally very, very important part. So that it's all based on teamwork. So that's what you are checking in interpersonal. Firstly with the team, and of course with the client is the second aspect, which they usually, it comes that if you have a good interpersonal, then obviously you will be able to manage with the clients as well. The third was leadership, which again is a very subjective thing. It's not usually very expected at this stage in terms of being very high, but a lot of that happens through the resumes also, in terms of screening, where they say, okay, have you tried to take some leadership position or some position of responsibility at campus? That's why I guess you will see some CGs, OCs, etc. usually getting shortlisted in most of these places. Right? So because they have at least demonstrated that they have taken a position of responsibility and delivered it. Right? The OC of TechWiz, the OC of MI does take responsibility and he does execute against it. And the last was business acumen, which will again be subjectively taken very from a case point of view, probably. Just seeing how you are making judgment calls, prioritization, how you are assessing your answer, yourself, kind of. So that will take
from making
that
people making this picture, from coming from that place to finding, as you said, your leader, with humble motivation. So what is the future do you see? Are you like contented, happy, and how do you see your like for what you want to do?
So our goal is still there, what we said, I think we want to, and I think we can get there, 10 million likes by 2018. But having said that, 10 million likes is not even like a drop in the ocean, right? We're talking of 700 million likes across India and all of that. So I think that's the humbling part, but 10 million in an absolute sense is quite good. So we still strive for that goal. We are, I think, moving towards it, we should be okay to get there. Let's see how it pans out. Having said that, I think the other way definitely we want to see this grow is we realize that we can't grow to the whole of India. So we are very, very, like the question he asked on franchising, for example. So those kinds of options are there. We haven't done it formally yet, but we want to work in a very open source kind of methodology. Somebody now in Bihar, UP, West Bengal, Rajasthan, anywhere says Bangalore, says I want to do this in Bangalore, can you help me out? So yes, we can reduce the 4.5 years that we have spent to maybe 6 months, 12 months for him, or him or her, and with them. That happens, yeah, we'll be happy. We may not come to our 10 million, but it's towards 7 million.
How do you compare PhD with the government?
You see, you'll say this is not career talk.
Because
any other career related question, you'll take it.
Do you recommend if someone has decided that he has to work to entrepreneurship? So do you recommend having a lot of skills first or jump right over?
So yeah, I think it depends again on to me.
Can you please repeat the question?
Because should we do a job before being an entrepreneur? Should we have job experience before going into entrepreneurship, or should we jump right over after?
Go for entrepreneurship right now. That's a fair question, I think. So, to me, two things I would try and structure. First is entrepreneurship, as I said, the key thing is the problem. Understanding what problem are you trying to solve. Right? So, oftentimes what happens, at least what I saw on campus, happened with me also, happens with people is they get excited about a solution. And particularly in technology, it happens a lot. Right? We sort of right now don't like that. But you do technology for technology's sake. Right? I have developed a product. Then let me try and find a market for it. Right? Entrepreneurship is ultimately taking something to the market. So for that, I think a step before saying market needs, what is the problem I'm trying to solve? So if you're clear of that, you see that yes, there is a need for such a solution. Then at some level, if it's then it's your call, right? How passionate you are about it. Because one thing about entrepreneurship is, and that's where it sort of steams out, is unless you are passionate about this problem, you can't keep going on. You will try it once, you will try it twice, if it does not work, you will let it go. That's why sort of startups stop after 1 or 2 years or that in through diarrhea, because oftentimes they're not clear of or not passionate about the problem they're trying to solve. They're more passionate about the solution. And then they start selling the solution. And they think, why are people not adopting it? Are you solving their problem? This is the first question. So if you find a problem which is something you're passionate about, then I don't think there is a right or wrong time to do it, honestly. In skill sets, you will develop it. You can pick that up. As I said, it's not that complex. As long as you're focused on the problem, it's a meaningful problem. So that would be my guess. Second is, of course, in my case, it helped. I'm working at a place like McKinsey. Helped a lot in terms of both ways, right? In terms of seeing the world, what kind of opportunities exist, in terms of understanding this, right? I am able to articulate this because of my sort of learnings from McKinsey, having seen that and a lot of other things, and synthesizing what I have seen before in the light of how business is done, learning that at McKinsey. So that helps a lot in what is a business like, in seeing the environment, how is business done, having been inside businesses, what is right, what goes, what works, what does not work. So seeing that aspect, and secondly, in building my own skills, in actually able to execute things in a very systematic manner. So I think it has helped. So there is, I wouldn't say it didn't help, so it definitely helps a lot. If I had done something like this, I wouldn't have even thought of doing this if I had not done it. So to me, it's as simple as that. So it helps, there is no doubt about it. But yeah, I think it's still finding, if you find a problem that you're passionate about, you want to solve it, go ahead and solve it.
What kind of job would you like to be, a small part of a big company or to be in a startup kind of to have experience?
To for what?
For like to have a startup after startup. So which experience is good? To be a part of a big company or be a part of startup? And second question is, why only healthcare you are now adopted? Why not education and other problems?
So startup versus a big company. So I can't comment that much honestly because I have not worked in startups in that sense. I did work while I was at IIT a little bit in a startup. I think there's the big difference I did. And even in big companies, there are two kinds of big companies. There would be a typical or more like a line job kind of a place where you are like going through the normal hierarchy, the management trainee, then someone senior like that. And then there is something like a consulting or a financial services. So the difference between those two kinds of big companies is I think the variety in some ways of the exposure of the industries. So in a consulting, financial services, etc., you will see much wider range of industries. You will see how business is done in different scenarios, not just in one. In a single company where you are there for longer, you will see how business is done there. So you will learn that. The difference between a big and a small company, my biggest would be in terms of processes that exist or don't exist. So in small companies, usually startups, like even to some extent ours till some time ago, and we are kind of transitioning into creating systems and processes as we are getting bigger. So till you are about 20-25 people, you can work with very loose processes. Like for example, we never had an attendance record till you were 25-30. We never tracked who is coming in, what time, going on what time, because every day I could actually see everyone coming in and going out, and I could mark them, point out. I would know if he hasn't come in today, did he work extra some other day, and all that can be done. But once you are 40-45, there is no way we can do it, right? And then we are about 8 centers, people are out there in the field. I don't know whether the nurse or the doctor is coming on time, not coming on time. Does it become like a PLC, like a government setup? So then you have to put systems in place, where in an automated fashion, first we start with a manual thing, then we have a register, a standard thing. So that would be the big difference between a big and a small company. So big company, there will be processes. Small company, you wouldn't see that, which is how can things work at scale. In a big company, you would see that. Right? So if I have to scale something, this is how it should look like. But the flip side, in a small company, you would be focused a lot more on solving a problem. In a big company, there will be problems, but there may not be as much problems. There it starts depending on the role. In a big company, if you have a role which is a challenging role, a role of responsibility, a role of doing things a lot more, then you will learn a lot more, which you would anyway be doing in a small company, because there is no choice. You can't sit idle. In a big company, you can have a good job, good salary, everything, but you may not have a good role. this happened to me. The first year at McKinsey, I was actually leaving after the first year. I had applied in Texas Instrument, I had bought an offer, I was about to leave because I didn't like my first 2-3 projects. Like, what is this? This is really boring stuff. And then the project I was on, by the time I got an offer, I started enjoying myself and I said, let's stay around and see why not. I've been here for a year, why start again? So I decided to stay on. So that happens in a big company, that you can get lost in the system. You will be the last, initially you will be the last guy they will care about. They will say, he should be happy, So that's what people used to tell us. So we were free because that time the bubble had burst actually. So there was ekdam job. Hum logo job se nikala nahi, that was a good thing. So when we went there was no project for us initially. So they said, they just put us on a project. अच्छा चार जन का काम है ये पांचवा जन फ्री में ले चुका है इसको भी रख लो कुछ करवा लेना इससे so that's how we were on project and we were not needed times so we were getting very bored कि क्या चल रहा है काम तो करवाओ ये so that happened so you are the last guy to respond
how does learning about our personal or management or problem solving skills vary from one job kind to another like from being a consultant to a trader or an IT professional thing. So how does this learning change? And if, especially for if you want to start up a venture someday in the future.
So I think the biggest difference is in the nature of problem solving. So in a consult, you would solve business problems across different industries, across different functions. In a regular job, like say an HUL, they would have a good program to rotate you, but essentially you would see only one business, right? Or one industry, how it works, maybe different functions there. In a trading sort of job, you would see more industry. You would understand the industry, maybe a company from a very outside point of view, right? You won't be interacting with the management. In a consulting, you would interact with the management, so you will get a more insider's view. Here you will get an outside view, but you will understand very well how the financial world works, which I still don't understand that well, honestly. Because as a consultant, you don't. I have never invested in stocks because I just don't understand how they move. Is there any rationality behind them? It looks very irrational to an outsider. But if you are a trader, you would understand that well because you have dealt with it day and day. So that's how sort of things will differ in terms of the level of depth you will get on a particular thing. In terms of breadth, it would be similar. You might see different functions. You might see, and anyway, you will interact with different functions even if you are in one function. So you will see what are the different functions in a company. You might even see different industries. But the depth will start varying based on where you are. If you are an IT company, your depth would be in sort of IT problems, right? You'll learn how to code very well, probably, if you are in a coding type. If you are in a consult, you would know management issues much better. You will be able to handle higher level business issues, but not grassroots level business issues. In a startup, you might learn grassroots level business issues a lot more because you are dealing with them. Everyone is, and so are you. You are interacting with the team day in and day out. You see what's happening. In a different job, like a trader, you would learn that thing very intensely. And what is trading about? How do the markets work? What influences them? What are the factors?
So now that I know someday I have to start something of my own, so isn't consultancy relevant to that framework? Because even if I'm a trader, I know financial markets, but then I'll be limited to just trading only. Probably I'll know how to read those charts and all. But again, to start a business, it's not helping me. Neither is IT professional job. Probably I can make a website of my own net business, but again, it's limited in its domain. So is it that consultancy is more open or wide?
To some extent, yes. I think it will give you a more wider view on what, in the management and business issues. Know much about it. And an insider is more important. You will be inside companies and not seeing them from outside. But you will be seeing them at a 10,000 feet level. So that is something you have to be aware of. So a lot of consultants don't make good entrepreneurs at the end of the day because of that issue. Because they continue seeing things at 20,000 feet level and don't understand what needs to be done on the ground to actually make things happen. Which their clients have been doing. They have never done. They have observed their clients, but they don't know necessarily what the client was doing. So that's something one has to be aware of. That's the flip side or downside of a consultant.
So are there any statistics to favor or support this argument that, okay, such professionals
I haven't come up with. So like, if you look at Google, Microsoft, these big companies, none of them were consultants beforehand. So try and find big companies where the founders were consultants. I think you will find, honestly, you will find fewer than more. You will find, the startup guy may not actually be ex-consultants. Ex-consultants will make good CEOs. So an IBM CEO is very likely to be an ex-consultant, which is a company which is made. So he knows how to run a big company from a 10,000 feet. But he may not know how to create a bottom.
What other exit options did you have
towards
the end of the second
year? Everything. That's a good thing. What else I would have been... I was getting offers which were quite similar in some of my other companies, my clients, some of the clients, which was very similar. But I had got specialized into healthcare and development. So those were the two areas I would be getting mostly offers from, not any industry. Because at that stage, I had got specialized. At a lower level, I wouldn't have got very senior job, but I could have changed industries or been more flexible about the industry. I could have gone into financial services very easily. So private equity, which is big investments in large companies. That kind of investments, consulting is their favorite poaching ground. So most consultants, a lot of consultants go there. Practically, a very wide at that point.
So in that case, these 6-7 years spent here versus
you worked
6-7 years there and
would
you have
reached
the same position?
Should
we compare
them to something like that? Yeah. So you would be
hired?
Than a line job.
No,
that's
a big question. Why health?
I worked in health mostly at McKinsey. I knew that industry better. I saw its effect.
Specialization or
interest? I think more ended up knowing it better. So that got me more interested. So it's a chicken and egg. I knew education, I understood education reasonably. I did a project there also. Probably the second thing on my back of my mind was education. A lot of people are doing it. So there are lots of NGOs which work in education, much more than health. I think health is a lot more ignored subject. Even if you look at the government, they do a lot more work in education than in health. Right? There will be more public schools than PhDs. They understand it's an easier. To me, at least, it's an easier problem to solve. So we are talking of a very different kind of interaction than anything. So, yeah, I think that could be another factor in my mind. There are more people solving it than people who are looking at this. Questions? I think back on, anyway, so for more specific Swasth India things, on 6th, I and Ankur, we are both back on campus for this student alumni Saturday 5 o'clock. So that day I think it will be mostly about Swasth and Ankur will also be there. So we can definitely talk more about it. But I think this question on startup is very on startup last I just want to definitely not leave you with the feeling that it's easy. It's tough. It usually feels very easy or feels very sexy at this stage, but I think you need a lot of energy to keep going on because it takes time. You'll enjoy it. If you like the problem you're solving, you'll enjoy it, which I am doing. And so we are enjoying ourselves, but it's not easy.
If I say I'm interested in the service sector and startups, and it is
those are the right questions you are asking, but those are very individual personal calls. Right? So, how much is enough money in my bank account that only you can decide for yourself and I can decide for myself. So you have to say that, if you do a startup, imagine 1 to 2 years almost, assuming there will be no inflow of money. Right? unless there is a clear funder or a backer behind it. Assume that's not there, whatever you have to live with it. So whatever that is. So that may mean, acha, this is my lifestyle, that's the implication based on the cash I have, this is your lifestyle. So can you accept that lifestyle? And that was a big shift for us from consulting where you were like usually ended up having to stay in 5 stars and that kind of thing. In our first 3 years, we were traveling back on a train, living in some guest houses right outside the station, which was 500 rupees a night type of places, the Southside station, and you know the kinds of places those are. That was a choice we took, and we said, yeah, we'll do that right now, because that's what we want to do. That was a big shift in lifestyle for us, so we did that. But that's, again, a very individual, personal call. And I think that if you're, again, passionate about the problem you're solving, then you will get the energy and motivation to do it. Otherwise, you may not. Otherwise, you may want to find, you'll start finding easier answers. Let's get a VC, let's raise some capital. Those, to me, are easier answers, and you end up diluting your company so much that you lose control of where it is headed. It loses the purpose that you started it for. It becomes a very different entity and you stop recognizing it or liking it sometimes. So that's the danger of it. So you have to, I think the best thing is accept the lifestyle and live with that. Otherwise you'll end up making choices which you may not like.
Saturday.
I have about 2-3 people have to come on Saturday and see if those faces are there or not.
I have a relevant face. So actually at our stage it's like more of this feeling of indecisiveness.
Yes.
Frankly speaking. So I'm not so sure what I want to do. So this is like a trap that I might go into some place which I would not eventually like. So I mean, how do we attempt to solve that?
Yeah, as I said, those were two my questions, right? So I basically said I wanted to see the world, what's real world like. And I want to discover myself. Those were the problem statements I kept for myself. So I understand most of you are in that phase right now. And I think if, as long as those questions are there honestly in your mind, wherever you go, you will, if you are looking for those answers and not other answers, like how much money I am making, like how much, this is a very philosophical point, but that's at least what I mean. And how much money I am making, what's my friend doing, what is he making. But instead focus on, am I growing, am I getting promoted, etc. Or focus on, am I finding who I am, right? So in terms of, am I understanding myself better, what I like, what I don't like. Am I learning about what's happening in the real world more? Those questions. Then I think you will be, wherever you are, whatever you are doing, you will start, you will reach your goal. Because that's a goal which is in your hand. Nobody controls that goal but you. Is am I learning and am I understanding myself? That's a goal entirely in your hand. You cannot fail on it. If you fail, you are only responsible, nobody else is responsible. Yes, some environments may give you a better chance and some may not. So you should try for getting the best environment. But if you're not still in any environment, you can get it. So again, example, if you're not in consultant, that's, let's say that's a dream job. It seems like I'll get the best, I'll understand the whole world, I'll get a huge variety of experience in the world. You don't go there. So one disadvantage I'll tell you of consulting which happened, as I said, it consumes you completely. Those 6.5 years, I practically did nothing else in my life. I traveled. Saturday, Sundays I used to get off. The only thing I could do then was actually rest. Because those 5 days I consumed. I would travel, etc. So that's the downside of consulting. I didn't see anything else but what McKinsey showed me. I was limited by that. That was fine. I learned a lot in that week, but I didn't see, actually didn't understand a lot that was happening outside, which I did once I came out. And I realized, oh, there's a lot there. I'm studying, I don't know, so I'm studying law right now, so I'm studying LLB. I joined the course, I'm learning law, I'm doing LLB right now, because I have the time. And that you can do enough based on the type of job you have, it's actually not that difficult to do. I spent a week every 4-6 months every semester preparing for 4 exams where I read those books and give the exam and I pass. It's as simple as that. But I'm learning. I know what legal is. That's the thing that you will need. And the reason I started it is because at work you will need it. So you start doing that. You can do those things. That's the, when if you're not in consulting, it gives you time to do maybe other things. If you get it. So I did a course in insurance, in actuarial studies. I started working on actually trying to redo a little bit of my maths integration differentiation, which I completely forgot in 8-10 years. And I know if I had done it while I was at IIT or just after IIT, I would have passed. Now I'm failing in those subjects. I have actually failed twice because we didn't have the time. And it's after 10 years, you forget what is the integration of e^(ax). Trust me, I had to do it from first principles in an exam where it suddenly came popped up. I forgot the formula of integration of e^(ax). So that happened. So it's, I think, philosophically, that's my take on it. That if you are focused on those questions, or you figure out what your questions are. Right? And if you're focused on those questions, trying to find answers for those, if your questions are, I want to make the most money, I want to grow the fastest, then focus on those. If you're focused on those questions, it's fine. Then it's in your control, you can't blame anyone.
Now that the questions are a bit general, that to restore myself or to develop myself are my goals, let's say. So, I mean, there is no particular defined goal as if I want to become this person after 5 years, 10 years. That is a very defined specific goal, right? So in that case, like we knew in 11th and 12th that we had to crack the, that was a specific direction. We knew what we had to achieve. Okay, keeping aside the learning part that we had gained during that time. So even if I want to learn and develop myself, they still have to be specific. I just cannot keep doing something to just develop, or I do not know what to do. I might be learning at anything at any place.
Yeah.
I can learn anything. But what is that thing? This is very confusing.
No,
but divert all my energy towards one direction. This
that's
is the problem. It's confusing.
That's a fair point. I think
it's a very fair point.
What I really try to do, and that is something I think at McKinsey came up and sort of I got that guidance, which has proved useful till the 6-7 years when I changed slightly. But essentially saying, plan or take your life 2 years at a time at this stage. Right? So think what you want to do next 2 years. After 2 years, so with a very definite goal, which sort of meets your these higher goals, but okay, this I'll do for 2 years. And then after 2 years, I'll decide. And the reason that 2 years, number 2 or 3 years, whatever you get comfortable with, that number came up was, you need at least that much time in trying to do one thing to get something out of it. Right? Particularly on these higher goals. If you start doing things at 3 months, 6 months, keep changing, then you won't be able to answer those questions by yourself because you haven't seen enough of it. So break your life right now in 2 or 3 years tranches the way you want. 2 or 3, and say, okay, next 2 years I'm going to do this. And then after 2 years, when I have done this for 2 years, I'll take a call again. So whenever you commit to somebody or commit anyone, commit for 2 years and stick to that commitment. Because that will take you through those, through that process. The only thing I changed after 6.5 years at McKinsey or to now, I do that instead of 2 years, it's become more longer, 5 years. In that, okay, now you move to a stage where let's try and do something for 5 years. If it works, it works. If it does not, then reanalyze. I could still continue doing it. That's what happened with McKinsey. 2 years, 2 years, 6 years, I realized I'm boring for that. Repetition was that it's not that much fun. And that's when I decided to leave in 6 months. So, but every 2 years, I used to take that call. Do I want to continue? Am I enjoying? Yes, I am really. Chalo, continue. Kya jata hai. So there is no downside. So that is some advice which McKinsey I got, and it's just helped. It's definitely been, because it solves that problem. You have a mega goal and it gives you a short term goal, which is required. It's very interesting.
I have a question about traveling, and you said the first thing you do is travel. You have to find people,
so travel was what we did was with initially with the NGOs. Again, the problem we were trying to solve was about healthcare. So we said let's understand the health situation on the ground. So we just went, worked, contacted local NGOs, said we want to solve this problem, and they were very kind enough to allow us because they could have said who are you? And I think that's where IIT named Health Chandra. It's a brand which works. That's a brand which works in rural India. That's a brand which works everywhere. Somehow people have a good respect for IITs in general, I think, which is good. We have to stand by. So that allowed us. They said, okay, come, you guys are good guys, you're trying to solve our problem. We want to encourage you. So the NGOs allowed us. So we said, okay, this is what we want to do. So we went to Rajasthan, went to a couple of villages there, Gujarat, slums in Ahmedabad, some villages there, Madhya Pradesh. So with various NGOs, we traveled. We went to villages, visited them, met, as I said, consumers. We asked them to hold a focus group. Or we said if you hold meetings like self-help groups, they have some meeting structures. So we'll participate there, we'll talk to them. So we asked people questions that were relevant to us. So that's essentially what we did in practice. It depends on what you're trying to do.
So, 6 years, 7 years in McKinsey, maybe the dream of a lot of people over here, you know, the team company, it pays you well, it has a good lifestyle, etc., etc., all that add-ons attached. And then you make a career transition, okay, an entire shift. So during that stage, no matter you tell that you're happy, you're bored of it or something, but then there should be some insecurity with respect to financials, with respect to some, you know, personal life, etc., etc. That insecurity, how did you deal with it? Like, there should be some, there should have been some thought in your head or something that would have backed you up in taking that leap from a conventional to
I think financial insecurity is a very personal choice, right? So that's, again, that's a very personal choice, as I said. So both of us just said whatever we have in our bank is good enough.
Okay, just go.
So whatever me and Uncle, we said whatever we have in our bank, we're happy with it. We'll, at least for the next 3 years, we commit, we're not expecting anything. We'll manage our lives. Having said that, I think the thing that definitely helped was I got married just around then when I was leaving McKinsey, and my wife supported it. So I think that was really helpful. If she had not, it would have been a much tougher choice than for me. Because she said it's fine. So partly, so she's joined First India now as well as of April. So that's a good thing that has helped. The second aspect of it, honestly, is that my mother has not yet accepted. So it's been 5 years and she still suffers from, I say suffer, but it's literally actually she suffers from the insecurity. So she's like, are abhi bhi, matlab at this, tera kya hoga. So it's mother's being mother, will always be mother. Why did you leave a job which was so good and so pain? So I had to fight that battle on my own terms, and I still, to some extent, fight it on my, it comes up, keeps coming up. In few months it will come up again. You fight it, so you live with that. So that's the thing I couldn't solve. So it's her insecurity in some way, she still feels. I'm saying I'm happy, there's enough. Our lifestyle is good, it's not bad. I'm having a reasonably good life, I'm not having a BMW. It's fine, I don't need a BMW. I'm happy with a Tata IndyCar, so I don't need a BMW. That's a choice, though. But she's still here. So both sides are there, so you will have to handle it. That's a call, and again, you have to make that choice.
This decision was more of a calculated decision or a
practical decision? So, leaving was, I think, decided in some ways. I definitely wanted to leave because I wasn't enjoying after a point. And I had stopped learning and all that was happening. So, I just said, see, and I didn't want to do this for the rest of my life. That was a fundamental. And that was a shift which was required. So, you had to do different things. Many, of course, most people in McKinsey choose to stay, right? So they choose to stay in the firm, stay in McKinsey, grow, do the normal things, become a consultant for life, or for a large part of their life, they leave at a later stage. So, yeah, leaving was that, I think, more what to do next was calculated in that sense, but it was thought through that what this health thing. As I said, at that time, it took a more four-year leave. 4 साल अब ये करना है मूव फ्रॉम 2 इयर्स टू 4 इयर्स आई थिंक 4 इयर्स वी वांट टू डू दिस देन वी विल सी 4 इयर्स हैव हैपेंड एंड मी एंड अंकल वी डिसाइडेड टू रिन्यू इट फॉर 4 इयर्स सी व्हाट हैपेंस ऑल दैट सी एंड आफ्टर
सो इट
वाज मिक्स ऑफ इंस्टिंक्ट एंड सम कैलकुलेशन टू फाइल
सो गवर्नमेंट
So government, so who in the government? Who will you try to contact the government?
Yeah, is there any chance
you can reach out to the government? You can't reach out to the government. You said then reaching out to people through the government. So is the government accessible?
Yeah, that's for example, it can be
service. This is a Saturday question. Saturday you are coming, 5 o'clock. I don't know where. Ankur will be there.
So I guess that's the end. So one last, like, give me a one-liner for, or two-liner or whatever. So a generic advisor for people who are thinking about careers in general, like, how should their thought process be like? Like, should it again be the same as that you told? you should be able to answer those particular questions.
So, I think my advice would be this, just think about, definitely think about the questions which are most important to you. These are definitely the choice you are making, you should be sure why you are making that choice. Right? So that's where the questions will help you on what is important to you. And this is the stage where you can do that. You can take risks, you can experiment in many ways, a lot more easy in some ways. As long as you are ready to fail, so you shouldn't get very disappointed with failure also. But I think it will be, to some extent it will be easier. So you can, but you should be very clear on the questions. I think that to me is one simple thing. Just try and ask what is important to you. So, and it can be, so there is no right or wrong. I have followed one path, there is a completely different path. So you can follow that path, which is, there is what's important to you is, first is material or career or growth or going up the hierarchy, growing in a place, etc. What could be important to you is more personal. So I think get clear on that. I think second is, honestly, at one level also don't take this too seriously at this thing. So we are at a, we have just, or when I also passed out, I thought I have just done undergraduation, right? I was 20 to 23, that's what you guys will be at also, right? When you pass out. So at that stage, that's just the beginning. If you think of your career, right? At least let's say all is well, we'll work till 60. Okay, so that's 38 years. It's going more than one sentence, but let me try and summarize it. But 38 years, right? So that's 38 years of work. That's what a career is, and it can go beyond. People work till 70, 80. You should be able to. So you're talking of a career of 40 years plus. Right? So in that 40 years plus career, if you spend 3-4 years initially exploring, experimenting, what would you like to do rather than committing at this stage? That is an opportunity you have at this stage to do. And so I would encourage you to try that. Figure out based on that what you want to do. Because it's a longest journey. It's not that tomorrow you have to decide what has to be done. Even marriage and all will come at least 6-7 years or maybe later. So responsibility. You can choose to postpone that to some extent. So just think of it in that, get that view that it's a 40-year thing. So there is a 40-year time frame in your career you're talking about, and not something which is, so you don't, it's not that critical a decision. It's not like point of no return. ये कर लिया तो यही हो गया आगे मैं कुछ और नहीं कर पाऊंगा आई कांट चेंज द पाथ अगेन इट्स जस्ट द बिगिनिंग एंड देयर आर अ मास्टर्स इज द इजीएस्ट वे टू चेंज द पाथ एट एनी पॉइंट सो दैट्स व्हाट एन एमबीए इज फॉर इफ एवर यू वांट टू चेंज अ पाथ यू वांट टू गेट इनटू एनी टाइप डू एन एमबीए इट विल ओपन अप ऑल न्यू डोर्स अगेन फॉर एनी इंडस्ट्री यू कैन गेट इनटू एनीथिंग यू कैन डू आफ्टर एन एमबीए आई एम करो उसके बाद वापस कैंपस प्लेसमेंट होगा दोबारा इट विल बी लाइक क्लीन स्लेट टू अ ग्रेट एक्सटेंट सो दैट्स द एडवांटेज ऑफ एन एमबीए सो डोंट think of your first job if you're thinking of a first job at this stage or anything, an MS, as this is it. It's just take it 2 years at a time at this stage. That would be my only, actually one line would be that, take it 2 years at a time.
Saturday.